I first developed an interest in studying the brain when I was in college. I took a course called physiological psychology, and I was fascinating because I found that the brain actually had parts and the parts actually did different things. And I was fascinated because this was actually a way to go into a system to try to figure out how you think, how you behave, really bring it down to the cellular level, which I thought was just fascinating and exciting work to do. And on top of that, it actually gave me a chance to apply something that could be useful and helpful to people in improving the human condition. I've been studying the effects of drugs on the brain for a while, and one thing we've been interested in is the interaction between different types of things that may predispose someone to drug abuse and the actions of the drugs. And one of the things we looked at was stress, because we know that stress can predispose people to drug abuse. Everyone knows that someone that's under stress can take a lot of alcohol, for example, but it also can predispose them to other drugs as well. So we were interested in just trying to find out what the relationship between these things are on a cellular level and try to relate that to why people actually take drugs. What we found when we looked at stress is that not all stressors are the same. There are some stressors that can make people anxious, worrying about a test, or having somebody threaten you. That type of anxiety can often lead to different types of behaviors. But there are other stressors, like stressors worrying about money, worrying about family situations, that can actually have the opposite effect and actually make you feel depressed. And it ends up that you can actually see the same thing in rats. Some stressors make the rats anxious, and they activate what we call the dopamine system, whereas other types of stressors have the opposite effect. They make the rats appear more depressed, and they actually downregulate the dopamine system. The dopamine system is a reward-related system that seems to be involved in basically all drugs of abuse and also in changing or modulating the mood states. One thing that's important when doing this research is we wanted to record from neurons that actually contain dopamine, the transmitter that's related to reward and the transmitter that's related to drug abuse. Now, to do this electrophysiologically, we wanted to actually determine which neuron our electrode is next to and whether it's the one that contains dopamine. What you see in this picture is what's called a histofluorescence graph, where we have neurons containing dopamine that were treated with a compound to make the dopamine fluoresce, just sort of like a black light poster fluoresces. What we did is to inject one neuron that we thought was a dopamine neuron with L-DOPA, the drug that's given to Parkinsonian patients to increase dopamine in their brain. And what you see is this very brightly fluorescing neuron is the one that was injected with L-DOPA. So that way we can tell that the neuron we were recording from was a dopamine neuron. One thing that's curious is how some drugs activate the dopamine system, and stressors also activate the dopamine system. And why would a stress and drugs of abuse actually do the same thing? Because drugs of abuse are rewarding, and stress is rarely rewarding. It's a curious thing that probably has to do with just the context or the type of environment a person is in. Drugs of abuse are known to be context dependent. In other words, you're not necessarily going to crave a drink when you're at the workplace, but if you're passing a bar, you might be tempted to go in and have a drink. People are more likely to smoke when they're in social situations and not when they're by themselves. So the context or the environment has a lot to do with whether a person takes drugs or not. Now, in the same way, stress is a context-dependent phenomenon as well. If you go into that first grade class where you had the mean teacher that always used to hit you with the ruler, you're going to feel the stress, not because you feel threatened right now, but because you have this context-dependent memory. So this context plays a role both with drug abuse and with stress. And interestingly, the context is all mediated by a certain part of the brain called the ventral hippocampus. The ventral hippocampus is what determines the context and then tends to change the rest of the brain to respond to the context. So stressors and drugs of abuse work through this common system to actually get the body ready to respond in an appropriate manner.